This video was made possible through the support of my patrons. In the early 2000s, the Doctor and Rose arrive on Earth to find a reeling planet. A flying object has just destroyed an iconic landmark, the media is scrambling, the population on edge, and our government is asleep at the wheel. But then comes the corruption. Those who want to use this event to take advantage of a frightened population, to plunge the human race into a perpetual war for the sake of profit with no actual enemy to fight. Doctor Who has never been a show to shy away from politics or direct political allegories in the past, but if the show was going to survive in its modern day form, it would have to adapt to the modern day political landscape. But does it succeed in its first multi-part story of the revival, no less? Well, that's what we're here to find out, on the trip of a lifetime. But before we dive in, don't forget to subscribe and hit that bell like a spaceship crashing into Big Ben, because it's time for Aliens of London and World War III. Now, it's not exactly a massive spoiler to say that this story isn't generally considered to be one of the best of Series 1. In fact, the consensus is that it's a generally fine two-parter. However, the Russell T. Davis penned two-parter Aliens of London and World War III is easily one of the most important stories of modern Who, or at least the Russell T. Davis era of the show, because it firmly establishes his era as the domestic era. You see, with the exception of the unit era during the Third Doctor's tenure, once a companion started travelling with the Doctor, that was their life, no semblance of home. This idea was slightly challenged towards the end of the classic series, as the Seventh Doctor took Ace home in the final story Survival to see some friends, but here, after a trip to the year 5 billion and 19th century Cardiff, Rose returns to the Powell estate to visit her mum. Rose, despite her slightly dismissive attitude towards her mum and her boyfriend, still isn't independent. She is 19 and lives at home after all, technically unemployed. So she heads home, being told that she has been gone for 12 hours and planning to say that she just spent the night at friends, only to turn up to a shocked Jackie, a home with missing person posters piled up on the table as if her mum has been at the centre of a big search campaign. It turns out, the Doctor steered the TARDIS wrong, and Rose has been away from home for 12 months. A slight improvement from last week after landing over 1,300 miles and 9 years away from Naples 1860, but 12 months is still an incredible amount of time for a person to disappear without a trace.
Do you know what terrifies me is that you still can't say? What happened to you, Rose? What can be so bad that you can't tell me, sweetheart? Where were you?
It's kind of hard to overstate just how big a personal shift this is in the modern series, because the show could have just ignored Rose's family. They were barely developed in the first episode, and what the show could have ignored wouldn't have hurt it to a certain extent. But in episode 4, they decide to tackle this concept head on. This also leaves Rose in a difficult situation of trying to explain where she's been to her mother, and also trying to explain her relationship with a northerner literally over twice her age in terms of appearance. Rose is back home, doesn't appear to have been kidnapped, so the police can't really do anything. But that doesn't make things easier for Jackie, who absolutely thrives in the anger stage of the grieving process.
Tell me where you've been.
Actually, it's my fault. I sort of employed Rose as my companion.
When you say companion, is this a sexual relationship?
No.
No.
Then what is it? Because you waltz in here all charm and smiles, and the next thing I know, she vanishes off the face of the earth. How old are you then? 40? 45? What'd you find her on the internet? Go online and pretend you're a doctor.
I am a doctor.
Prove it. Stitch this, mate.
Oh, oh.
She slapped
slapped you?
900 years of time and space, and I've never been slapped by someone's mother.
I also think we didn't quite know how good Camille Cadori was when she was part of the series. Her anger is entirely justified, but she's also able to sell the idea of Jackie almost getting back to normal immediately with a house party to celebrate Rose's return and the impending first contact.
Is to the Martians!
And the shock and the relief of her daughter's return, part of me kind of wishes it got played up a bit more, to be honest, especially how Jackie might have felt about her daughter going missing after also losing her husband a few years back, but that's for another episode. But Jackie isn't the only affected party here, as we also have Rose's boyfriend Mickey, who was a pariah at the estate because he was the chief suspect in her disappearance. In fact, he was considered a murder suspect.
In 12 months, have you been seeing anyone else?
No.
Okay.
Mainly because everyone thinks I murdered you.
Right.
We'll talk about Mickey later, but I will say now that they do kind of gloss over Mickey's ruined reputation pretty darn quickly here. However, I'm not an unreasonable person. Doctor Who is not an EastEnders-style drama. I mean, it can flirt with the format, but it's not where its heart lies. It's in the alien-based science fiction fantasy narratives, and this two-parter, understandably, focuses more of its screen time on that. And thankfully, we didn't have Rose coming home, then just 40 minutes later, flying away in the TARDIS again. We do have a two-part story, meaning that both plots in both genres get time to breathe. So let's talk about that alien story. Just as Rose is thinking that she's alone in the world, thinking aliens exist, a spacecraft flies above the London skyline, crashes into the side of Big Ben, and lands in the Thames. Now, this is a prime example of Russell T. Davis wanting both his cake and eating it too. He's able to script an alien crash landing where he gets to check off iconic London landmarks and make it tick all of the boxes, whilst also drawing attention to it.
It's not an invasion. That was a genuine crash landing. Angle of descent, colour of smoke, everything. It's perfect.
All right, so I lied. I went and had a look, but the whole crash landing's a fake. I thought so. It's just too perfect. I mean, hitting Big Ben, come on.
It turns out that this crash was engineered as a way to get the world panicking and gathering experts to Downing Street, where the family Slitheen, disguised as members of government, assassinate the only humans who can stop them, then pretend that there's evidence of an alien threat and use the planet's nuclear arsenal to destroy the planet and sell off the radioactive remains. Now, for all of the recent and, quite frankly, stupid talk of Doctor Who apparently never being political, Aliens of London isn't just about selling the novelty of seeing large green-skinned aliens running around 10 Downing Street, but actually drawing direct parallels to the world in 2005, as we have the government wanting to capitalize on a terrorist event in order to drum up public support for a war that can result in massive profits on the basis of lies. We've got their leader, Joe Crasser Felfotch Pasimir Day Slitheen, who killed the MP for Hartley Dale, Joseph Green, and ends up becoming Prime Minister after the Slitheen family killed Tony Blair and stuffed him in a cupboard. He then goes on live TV and, quoting almost verbatim what US President George W. Bush said when giving his reasonings for invading Iran.
I take the fact that he develops weapons of mass destruction very seriously.
Tonight, British servicemen and women are engaged from air, land and sea. Their mission? To remove Saddam Hussein from power and disarm Iraq of its weapons of mass destruction.
Our inspectors have searched the sky above our heads, and they have found massive weapons of destruction capable of being deployed within 45 seconds.
What?
And when the Doctor lays it out bare, even Rose Tyler brings up the parallels to our reality.
She's making it up. There's no weapons up there, there's no threat. He just invented it.
Do you think they'll believe him?
What he did last time.
That's why the Slitheen went for spectacle. They want the whole world panicking because you lot, you get scared, you lash out.
They release the defence codes.
And the Slovene go nuclear.
Now, putting aside the fact that in order to tell this story of aliens faking an alien crash for profit, that kind of means it leans into the idea of 9/11 being an inside job, which in reality is nonsense, but in this fictional parallel, it's basically the case, and I don't hold anything against people who hate this two-parter for that inadvertent endorsement. But putting that aside, this really is a novel way for an alien invasion to unfold. The Slovene family infiltrate the government, get the world panicking, and use the idea of mutually assured destruction to destroy Earth. Great premise, I think it actually sticks the landing and is thematically appropriate for the time of broadcast. Heck, Doctor Who would hardly be the last to depict 9/11 as a metaphor. A couple of months later, Steven Spielberg's War of the Worlds would take the imagery and impose it on H.G. Wells' classic story, and the Marvel Cinematic Universe would use it as the backbone of their second phase, with a tragic event happening in New York and America using draconian policies to combat future threats. However, I do think that the path it takes to get there, and also some of the character work along the way, is a bit sloppy. Now, once again, being fair, Rose was just one episode, with the alien invasion playing second fiddle to the introduction of these characters. This two-parter is way more ambitious. Rose was a tightly written story, but this one is way laxer with the details, and the audience have to make some massive leaps. Like, I'm not gonna claim to be an expert in the inner mechanisms and the workings of UK politics, but it seems kind of nuts that if the Prime Minister goes missing and if London is gridlocked, that a random MP who just happens to be nearby, in this case the MP for Hartley Dale and the chairman of the Parliamentary Commission of the Monitoring of Sugar Standards and Exported Confectionery, would just become Prime Minister. Honestly, I don't see why we couldn't just have had the fictional Prime Minister be a Slovene in disguise. Yeah, the episode says the Slovene could not use him because he was slim and the Slovene needed larger bodies to hide inside, but the Slovene are fictional aliens and fictional rules apply. The workaround and the limitations are entirely self-imposed by the writer. Also, I'm amazed that every military apparatus online can be overridden by the password Buffalo. It's hardly the strong 10-character, multi-number and symbols password that you'd expect from a government defense system. And I also doubt that Mickey, using his PC in the Powell estate, could just click and launch a missile off the coast of Plymouth. Are these nitpicks? Absolutely. However, I think the more lapses in logic there are in a story, the harder the audience has to work to suspend their disbelief. Your own personal threshold for these things will vary. For me, I don't really care too much. What I do care about, though, is character. And while there are times and moments where this story excels, we'll get to that shortly, there are also times where it feels a bit haphazard. Like, I love the Doctor's reaction to domestic. We've never seen a Doctor thrown into a scenario like this before. Him trying to watch the news and getting interrupted by partygoers and a random toddler is endlessly funny to me. He decides to get away, and Rose wants to make sure that he's not just leaving, so he gives her a TARDIS key, though of course, he's got a spare. My favourite moment of this scene is that when he gives Rose the happy-go-lucky speech about human growth, he turns around and the look on his face, he really just wants to get away from there. That makes the preceding speech basically a massive put-on, like a rehearsed monologue, and he doesn't actually mean it.
First contact, the day mankind officially comes into contact with an alien race. I'm not interfering, because you've got to handle this on your own. That's when the human race finally grows up. Just this morning, you're all tiny and small and made of clay. Now you can expand.
I love that. It demonstrates that this Doctor, despite his fondness and love of humanity, does see himself as above it all. However, this is another example of Russell wanting his cake and eating it too, because in this same story, we have the Doctor wanting to swan off and do this adventure on his own, and then in the end, when the Doctor has to decide whether or not to use the missile to destroy the Slovene...
I could save the world but lose you.
Now, both interpretations of the character are valid and worthy of exploration, But these both happen in the same story, without Rose Tyler doing anything especially significant in the interim. The story also, I think, doesn't do enough to expand on Jackie Tyler. I bet that you forgot that this is the first time Jackie saw the inside of the TARDIS, and I don't blame you because she's just in the background and not in focus when she steps inside for the first time. Jackie is such an afterthought in what should be a pivotal moment that when she rings up the alien helpline in the next scene, she uses the name TARDIS, despite it never being said in her presence prior. Also, while I'm at this scene...
There have been at least 3 reports of public assault on people falsely identified as aliens.
That line's actually a bit depressing. I can guarantee you that none of those citizens attacked would have been white. And speaking of dubious Jackie phone calls...
One phone call? Just to know that you were alive.
So, what was that in the end of the world? I'm not expecting an in-depth timeline of events for the past 12 months, but it feels odd to not have that pivotal scene from a few episodes ago get mentioned. And it's not just our central cast who have shortcomings in the character department, but our villains as well. Actually, that might be incorrect phrasing because I actually thought that their characterization was solid. These aliens who can put up a serious front, and I think the actors do their best work in these moments, particularly Annette Badland as Margaret. There's a reason why she only gets 2 scenes to herself in the story and yet became the audience favorite and the clear choice to return later on in series 1, but once again, that's for later.
Leave this planet or I'll stop you.
What? You? Trapped in your box?
Yes. Me.
However, when it comes to the comedic farting around, I do think it drags things down. I think the bloodless violence, the inherent spectacle of running Benny Hill style through Downing Street, fighting with a fire extinguisher and such, makes this family friendly already. The farting on top of it just feels like dumbing down. The balance between jokey Slitheen and serious Slitheen can be pretty well demonstrated already, particularly near the end.
Sergeant. We'll take the call in the Prime Minister's office. Maintain your positions. Good luck.
Oh, God. Oh, look at that! The telephone is actually red.
How long till they phone? Counting down.
But the farting as well? It's a bit much. The only reason this initial undressing works at all is because actor Rupert Vassitat as General Asquith makes for a brilliant, lone, sane man in the room. He plays it completely straight, and he brilliantly grounds the cabinet room reveal. Not to mention, despite shaking her booty and joking about it in front of their next victim, Margaret does bring up this problem in the next scene.
Madam. We've really got to fix the gas exchange. It's getting ridiculous.
I don't know, it seems very human to me.
So this farting is partially performative, but it does go a bit far.
The only people with the knowledge how to fight them gathered together in one room. Excuse me, do you mind not farting while I'm saving the world?
Would you rather silent but deadly?
It's absolutely a case of tone here. Now, I'm 90% sure that this is indeed how most right-leaning politicians do act behind closed doors, but the Slitheen do their best work in this episode when they do get more serious, which often comes in the form of undressing. The actual Slitheen designs and the incredible costume and effects work really is a sight to behold. Yeah, some of the CGI is dated and the CGI Slitheen running in the corridors just looks really bad, but those hulking, walking, talking costumes that blink and snarl and grab, it's seriously impressive work. The baby faces are also really inspired. The metal devices around their necks are a clever way to break up their designs, and things like the hyphenated surnames, the low-tech zipper on the forehead, and the weakness to vinegar, that feels very Douglas Adams. Also, I adore this scene where more members of the family start arriving at Downing Street. This is the humour that works best when it comes to this family.
There you are, if you just like
get together and get changed. Now, if you'd like to head down to the end of the corridor, it's first on the left.
Thank you.
Once again, Annette Badland is wonderful at selling this casual element to the family affairs. There's some really solid performances from the Slitheen family. Steve Spires is great as Officer Strickland in what, to me, was the action highlight of the episode, as he unmasks and breaks into Mickey's flat.
I'll take you on, Jackie. You just run. Don't look back. Just run.
And moments like that is where this two-parter stands out. See, on a large scale level, I think this story either drops the ball or doesn't explore the depths of its characters. However, in the small scale character moments, the story's full of them. Mickey basically offering to sacrifice himself to save Jackie, not hesitating to whack a Slitheen with a chair. This guy is not the same person he was 12 months ago. We've got the unnamed secretary, who was a pretty big presence in Aliens of London, only to be murdered by Margaret and he's put to rest in World War III.
What was his name?
Who?
This one, the secretary or whatever he was called.
I don't know. I talked to him. I bought him a cup of coffee. I never asked his name.
Sorry.
And Harriet Jones, while not really having much to contribute plot-wise, is a great presence. Penelope Walton should have been a full-time companion, not even as MP for Flydell North, just Penelope Walton. And we also have the Ninth Doctor exploring Albion Hospital solo, which almost gives us a glimpse into a pre-Rose Doctor. Also, I couldn't help but realise when watching this scene where he's piloting the TARDIS on his own as he's dancing around, hitting the console with a hammer, there's got to be at least half an hour of B-roll footage of Eccleston just running around that set on his own. Will we ever see that? Maybe for the Series 1 Blu-ray collection in 30 years' time? I also remember 12-year-old me being captivated by his performance in the cabinet room when Rose and Harriet are throwing knowledge at him so he can narrow down where the Slitheen came from. This guy just has a universe's worth of knowledge in his brain that he needs help to access, and when he lands on it, there's genuine joy.
Calcium phosphate, organic calcium, living calcium, creatures made out of living calcium. What else? What else? Hyphenated surname. Yes! That narrows it down to one planet. Raxicorico Phalopatorius!
Oh, yeah, great, we can write him a letter.
Also, this scene was the first day on set for Christopher Eccleston, and I think it's really fitting for this character that the first time that he embodied this role is defending the frightened space pig. Oddly enough, while the pig might be a step too far for some viewers, I like it in that it gives the Doctor a brilliant way to respond to it. Firstly, it's set up with this horror set piece with Naoko Mori as Toshiko Sato, a role that she would reprise over a year later in Torchwood, though in the credits for this episode, she's only Dr. Sato. Then we're expecting some alien creature, only to find... I love that openness. Like, no, it's not just going against expectations, it's literally just a pig in a suit. It's not formal, it doesn't talk, it's just a pig. Unfortunately, it squeals and runs away, only to get shot at. It's then revealed that alien technology turned an ordinary pig into an elaborate dummy, and it was forced into a spaceship that was programmed to crash. Just listen to how sincerely Eccleston delivers this exposition, but I think with the Doctor, it couldn't have been played any other way.
I just assumed that's what aliens looked like. But you're saying it's an ordinary pig from Earth.
More like a mermaid. Victorian showmen used to draw the crowds by taking the skull of a cat, gluing it to a fish, and calling it a mermaid. Now someone's taken a pig, opened up its brain, stuck bits on. Then they've strapped it in that ship, made it dive bomb. It must have been terrified. They've taken this animal and turned it into a joke.
On the other hand, it does offer a stark contrast with how he treats Mickey. At first, I thought his jabs and insults were just him being a bit of a dick, but upon reflection, I think it runs deeper than that. Yeah, he might not have the highest opinion of Mickey, but he's being confronted with some pretty hard truths here. Mickey's even been watching some of the classic series to make a point.
UNIT, United Nations Intelligence Task Force, good people.
How do you know?
Because he's worked for them.
Oh yeah, don't think I sat on my backside for 12 months, Doctor. I read up on you. You look deep enough on the internet or in the history books and there's his name, followed by a list of the dead.
Is the Doctor trying to bring Mickey down in order to justify to himself that it was okay for him to essentially sabotage this innocent guy's life? That theory is supported by the beautiful epilogue at the end, where after Mickey has proven that he's able to make sacrifices and is able to deal with the hard choices, he has a one-on-one with the Doctor.
I just went down a shop, and I was thinking, you know, like the whole world's changed. Aliens and spaceships all in public. And here it is. How can they do that? They saw it.
Firstly, after the past year that we've had, that open denial from the mainstream public is very relatable. But secondly, and I'm stealing a line from YouTuber Davis here, that line right there is the kind of line that recruits a companion. The Doctor not only reneges on his prior insult of calling Mickey an idiot, but admits that he's right in that he's dangerous and gives Mickey a flash drive that will wipe out all mention of him from the internet so that others can't follow him. He even offers Mickey a chance to travel, but...
Because you're right. I am dangerous. I don't want anybody following me.
How can you say that and then take her with you?
You could look after her. Come with us.
I can't. This life of yours, it's just too much. I couldn't do it. Don't tell her I said that.
Come with us. There's plenty of room.
No chance. He's a liability. I'm not having him on board.
We'd be dead without him.
My decision is final.
I love this, how the Doctor essentially takes the fall and pretends to be worse than he is in order to protect Mickey's integrity, or at least how he's perceived by other people. Friend goals right there. And Jackie doesn't want Rose to leave, fearing for her life after how close she came to missile destruction just that day. And look at the Doctor and Mickey in the background here. It seems like Rose is the only character in this quartet that doesn't understand the reality of the situation here. All of the small character stuff I adore. Harriet Jones's reaction behind the curtain to her scent, Jackie threatening to stop Mickey from potentially killing her daughter, the Slovene maybe being able to have escaped had they not reveled in their victory by undressing. Oh, and these two supporting artists who play the security team. I love these two. Give these two honorary BAFTAs.
I think you'll find the Prime Minister is an alien in disguise. That's never gonna work, is it?
No.
What the hell is that for?
Service emission! Sorry.
Yeah, the small stuff is stellar, and that's where this story finds its heart and made it a solid rewatch. It's just the big stuff that feels half-baked and drags the whole 90-minute story down. Like, the episode ends with Downing Street destroyed and the Prime Minister dead. That sounds like something that a speech from the MP for Flydale North is not gonna fix. Oh, I almost forgot to talk about the cliffhanger, the first one in over 15 years. It's a good one, where the cliffhanger takes a three-pronged approach, as the Doctor is being electrocuted, Rose and Harriet Jones are about to be attacked by Margaret Slovene, and Jackie gets cornered by Strickland Slovene in the kitchen. It's bold, and I like it a lot, though the Doctor just grabbing the electrified ID tag and attaching it to one member of the family without anything approaching resistance and also getting everyone's survival ruined in the next time trailer does let the side down somewhat. But these are, on the whole, mostly nitpicks. There's a lot to talk about with this ambitious two-parter, and it's spinning a lot of plates. To its credit, it mostly works. I just think it stumbles in a lot of separate areas without really detracting overall from the whole. As a modern-day alien invasion story slash political satire slash domestic drama, it works. I also love and appreciate these small-scale successes, and in hindsight, it absolutely set the template for modern Who moving forward, as in giving the companions more dimension, and a family life to return to, and a grounded edge that it never had in the classic series. But as a story on its own, it's not really something that I'll be desperate to revisit anytime soon. Definitely has its moments, though. Next week on The Trip of a Lifetime, I won't be talking about Dalek, mainly because I've already reviewed it and re-reviewed it and did a feature-length breakdown on its direction with the episode's director, Joe Ahern. So next week, for Dalek, we'll do something a bit different, and The Trip of a Lifetime will continue after that. I hope you've been enjoying the format change. If you are, please, you know, hit that like button, subscribe, all that good stuff. Join me next week for something unconventional with Dalek, and then after that, we go back into the future to mankind's potential downfall in the long game. I'll see you folks next time. Hey everyone, you made it to the credits, which means that you didn't rage quit when I talked about politics, which means that you are awesome and should be recognised as such. So thanks so much for making it to the end of this review of Aliens of London and World War 3. Be sure to subscribe to keep up to date on this trip of a lifetime journey that we're taking. We're now currently several weeks into it now, massively enjoying the retrospective, and I hope you folks are too. You can help to appease the almighty YouTube algorithm by hitting like, by leaving any comment down below, and also I'd like to give a shout out to my patrons, whose names should be scrolling on the side of the screen right now, and I'd like to give a particular shout out to Anne Neubauer, Matthew Perry, James Raby, Dean Jones, Andrew Blewett, Callum Baird, Daniel Davis, Dylan Whitaker, Flabu, Joseph Adams, Katie Maxwell, Luna Day, Palex, Raven Woods, Rebecca Hill, Shazeb Mangi, The Brit Sniper, Zachary Taylor, aka Mario Fanboy 15, Dan Morrison, Darius, Nathaniel Holden, Samuel Brooks, Zabi555, and Luke Jenkins. So thanks so much to all of my patrons. You can help to support this channel and help to keep the lights on by becoming a patron, getting loads of perks, getting these reviews and videos way earlier than everybody else. Your support is massively appreciated during these times. So, hope you enjoyed the video. See you next week for something maybe a bit unexpected. I'll see you folks next time.